I would like to read. If it be asked in connection with our title whether we have the right to place any of Shakespeare's plays, even the mature ones, in the category of sacred art, a powerful plea for yes is implicit in the fact that the central theme of these plays is not merely religion, which in itself would be insufficient, but the very essence of religion, namely the mysteries. Let us add to this remark from Schuon's masterly chapter on the degrees of art. This is in his book, in the book of Frithjof Schuon, the late Frithjof Schuon, called Esoterism, and he speaks of the degrees of art. He says, the distinction between a sacred and a profane art is inadequate and too precipitate when one wishes to take account of all artistic possibilities, and it is therefore necessary to have recourse to a supplementary distinction, namely that between a liturgical and an extra-liturgical art. Now, an example of a liturgical art would be the great cathedrals, the great Gothic cathedrals, for example. They are sacred art in every sense of the word. But this distinction in what is sacred art, distinguishing between a liturgical and an extra-liturgical art, this distinction has the advantage of safeguarding the already mentioned category of sacred art in the traditional sense, while at the same time not labelling as profane certain extra-liturgical manifestations of the divine spirit, which bloweth where it listeth, as I say, and that allows us to include the plays of Shakespeare in as extra-liturgical art, that is, art which has not any liturgical place, but at the same time it comes from the spirit. It comes by inspiration in the literal sense. And that is true, as I have said, of much music which did not suffer in the way that the other arts like architecture, sculpture, painting did suffer after the Renaissance.
May I ask you this question?
Yeah.
So many today who are teaching Shakespeare do not mention the more esoteric and profound spiritual themes in Shakespeare as they were apparently understood by many in the Elizabethan time. Why are our professors and teachers seeming to neglect these spiritual or deeper aspects in Shakespeare's works?
Because nobody knows. How should they know? Nobody thinks of religion in that way. They look on Milton's poetry, for example, as spiritual or religious, but it would never occur to them to think of Shakespeare as being much more spiritual than Milton, truly spiritual in an inner sense.
Is there some change in the way Shakespeare is taught or performed that you would suggest that would give the reader or an audience a better understanding of the depth and magnitude of his works?
I have said in my notes, my notes on performance and production, how can actors and directors best do justice to the deeper meaning of Shakespeare's plays? A general answer to this question is by being as faithful as possible to the literal meaning. Take care of that, and the deeper meaning will take care of itself. To be true to the literal meaning is less easy and more exacting than it may sound. Shakespeare's mature plays, even as regards their literal meaning, center around human perfection, if not already achieved, at any rate in the making. A perfection that is absolute and unsurpassable. And I quote from Hamlet's reference to his father, a combination and a form indeed, where every god did seem to set his seal, to give the world assurance of a man. That is Hamlet's reference to his father. And we see in play after play that the character, the central character, develops himself from imperfection to a most remarkable fullness of perfection. When you take, for example, King Lear, he begins off as a man full of faults. By the end of the play, when he's going off to prison with Cordelia, he says, come, let's away to prison. We two alone will sing like birds in the cage. When thou dost ask me blessing, I'll kneel down and ask of thee forgiveness. So we live and pray and sing and tell old tales and laugh at gilded butterflies. And hear poor rogues talk of court news, and we'll talk with them too, who loses and who wins, who's in, who's out, and take upon us the mystery of things as if we were God's spies. To take upon us the mystery of things. King Lear has changed from an extraordinarily imperfect man to a man of greatness and goodness. And this brings me to a point which is interesting and not generally noticed, that in Shakespeare's plays, for example, in Hamlet and Othello, it's noticeable that Shakespeare brings into the play a character, a lesser character, who possesses in all fullness what is lacking in the chief character. Now this is, in Hamlet, that person is Laertes. He is quite inferior to Hamlet as a character as a whole, but he does possess, fully developed, what Hamlet needs to develop. And when he hears, he's in France, he's gone to France for his education, when he hears of his father's death, he hears that the king is responsible, the usurping king Claudius is responsible, he comes back to Denmark. He gathers together a kind of army. He goes to the palace. He breaks through the palace guards. He confronts the king and says, oh, thou vile king, give me my father. Where is my father? I mean, he has everything just that Hamlet needs to develop. Now, in Othello, this is quite a different. The the person I mentioned as the fourth character in this small simple play, the wife of Iago, the devil, she has, she is the companion servant of Desdemona, the heroine. And very quickly, she comes to love her mistress and to see her extraordinary perfection, because Desdemona in this play symbolizes the divine spirit. She represents there is in all Shakespeare's love plays duality of heaven and earth, whereas the one character, one of the couple, represents the divine spirit. When Othello at the end of the play says soft to his last speech, a word or two before you go, when you shall these unhappy events relate. I better take it from the original, I think, because I cannot always remember the. He tells them to tell the truth when he goes back, when they go back to Venice. They say that he must come with them, but he begins his last long speech, soft you, a word or two before you go. And those words are significant, that we don't know it at the time, that he is not going to go with them because he is going to kill himself then and there. And he tells them, when you shall these unhappy events relate, I can't remember the exact words, tell them the truth. Don't put down anything in malice, but. And then he says of himself, then you shall speak of. I forget the words, but he describes himself of one that loved not wisely, but too well. Yeah. Of one that loved not wisely, but too well. That is, of one who loved too passionately, was too passionately in love with his wife, but failed to see her extreme virtue, failed to see fully. Now, Emilia, the servant companion of Desdemona, very quickly comes to look on Desdemona as a saint, and she does love wisely and not well, and she is there at the end of Othello to confront Othello, she speaks with the certitude. It's impossible for Iago to deceive his wife. He's deceived Othello, but it's impossible for him to deceive his wife about Desdemona. Completely impossible. She would never have she was never near to being deceived by her husband that Desdemona was guilty. And when he tells her that Desdemona had betrayed Othello and had been unfaithful to him with Cassio, she knows it's not true. She loved wisely, not only well, but wisely. And she is there. It is, in fact, a wonderful thing in Othello, after all that the audience has been through, In the last scene of Othello, when Emilia comes on to the stage, and when Desdemona is already dead, although she's not, she isn't dead actually at that moment, because she speaks from her bed when Othello thought she was dead. And Emilia goes to her and says, "Who has done this?" And Desdemona says, "Nobody, I myself. Farewell. Commend me to my kind lord. Oh, farewell." Now, commend me means, say in Shakespeare Lings, means speak well of me to my kind lord. And Othello says to Emilia, "You heard what she said." Thoughts come to him at the moment that Desdemona's last words, that she herself was responsible for her death. It's possible that the thought crosses Othello's mind that he could take advantage of that. There is a witness present that Desdemona had said with her last breath that she was responsible for her own death. People saw in those days, the average person was not well informed, but I'd like just to read something from the book itself here. "There can be no longer any doubt that already at the age of 30 or before, Shakespeare was familiar with the various doctrines, some truly esoteric, some others merely occultist, which so passionately interested the London dramatists and other writers of the day, as well as the aristocrats who sustained, protected, and encouraged them, including two successive patrons of the players for whom Shakespeare wrote his plays, and with whom he acted. Needless to say, the mainstream of the mystic legacy of the Middle Ages was Christian, but by the end of the 16th century, it had been swelled by many tributaries, Pythagorean, Platonic, Kabbalistic, Hermetic, Illuminist, Rosicrucian, Alchemical. In the margin of some of these traditional currents were sciences such as astrology and magic, and many minds were captivated and even monopolized by side issues of this kind. But centrally, the non-Christian traditions coincided with Christian mysticism despite differences of terminology and perspective. They were concerned, firstly, with the means of purifying the soul of its fallen nature, and finally with the fruit of that restoration of the primordial state, the soul's beatific reunion with God." That was the center of all these different currents which prevailed, and which, as I say, interested not only the aristocrats as a whole, or many of them, but also including two successive patrons of Shakespeare's troupe, the troupe with which he acted and for whom he wrote his plays.
You mean the Lord Chamberlain's men, Lord Hunsdon, and then the patron King James?
Also, I forget the yes, King James, of course, was the first performance of King Lear was done for, he was present, the king was present at the first performance of King Lear. We know that. And they were interested in these doctrines, which, as I say, centrally coincide with the essence of Christianity, that is the purification of the fallen soul. And this is the theme of Shakespeare's great plays. Play after play, we see that the central figure has to be purified of faults, and by the end, he becomes perfect. This applies to... there is one exception among the great plays, and that is Macbeth, because Macbeth is centered round the villain. It's clear that Hamlet, Macbeth is really Claudius, the Claudius of Hamlet, that is the king, yes. The villain, brought into the center and made the central figure. And it's true that the final impact of Macbeth is less powerful than that of the other great plays, but it could be made if the parts of if the part of Malcolm, the small part of Malcolm, who ends by being King of Scotland, and who was in life, in historical life, the husband of a canonized saint, St. Margaret, if he were, if his part were well acted, and his father's part, King Duncan, if they were really well acted, that would make a difference to the total impact. One would feel that the scene in England, in which Malcolm appears and in which he develops to a certain extent, that could be bring people's interest to be centered rather on a bit more on him than they are on Macbeth.
Yes.
The total effect of, I think it must be generally admitted that the total effect of Macbeth is less powerful in this positive sense I'm speaking of than that of Hamlet, Othello, King Lear, or Antony and Cleopatra, or The Winter's Tale, or The Tempest.
In the plays, there's the opportunity for performance.
Yeah.
In the sonnets, in the poetry of Shakespeare, there is depth there. How is one to pull out of the sonnets or the other poetry the depth? It's not necessary for performance to take place for this effect upon the audience, is it?
It needs the disadvantage of lyrical poetry over dramatic poetry is that people go to the theatre in order to be spellbound. You might say, well, what is the advantage of that? To be drawn into the events of other people's lives. What is the advantage of that? You might say that in most cases it has no spiritual advantage, but when the play itself portrays a great soul which is being purified of its fault, and towards perfection, which it reaches at the end, it is no light thing to be drawn, to be spellbound and drawn into the web of the play. And it can be a very great spiritual experience to see a play of Shakespeare adequately well acted, and provided that one is faithful, as I say, to what Shakespeare wrote, and provided the producer, in order to be original, to be hailed as original, does not alter things or exaggerate things which are not there at all.
In the classroom, what I have been hearing from some students or those who look back upon their experience in the classroom is, oh, the professor was so dry, or it was so dismal. But with younger people now that I've spoken with, not those who are looking back on their past education, they seem to be more interested and willing to see the depth, and it seems to be more exciting. So having taught Shakespeare yourself, if you were to be magically in front of a young group of students, how is your appreciation of Shakespeare now? How would it come out in your teaching of the material?
Well, in my teaching, I went through the plays as they are written, the literal meaning of the play, what I'm saying. It is a great soul being purified of its faults to a final perfection. That is the theme of Hamlet, King Lear, of Othello, of Antony and Cleopatra, of Cymbeline, The Winter's Tale, and The Tempest. This is more complex, some of the plays, of course, in that way than others, but that is true of all these plays. And I can make the students feel that. I don't need to say anything but to point to, I need to quote from the play to explain that this was what interested the people in the Middle Ages, the purification of the soul.
Yes.
Each play shows us this process of purification. And one doesn't need to speak about, I mean, one has the plays themselves, they witness that.
I took you off of the path a little bit. You had given us this history where you had gone to Egypt, you began the teaching, and then you came back to this performance, and I think you wanted to mention then where you came earnestly to the profundity of Shakespeare's works, and then you actually began writing on the topic.
Well, I came through teaching Shakespeare. I was teaching the text, I was going through the text, and I realized, as my friend had also realized, that I never spoke to him about it. I didn't have time because he died very shortly after making this remark to me. When I started producing plays, the students in plays, then I learned one or two things about the amazing gifts that Shakespeare as a dramatist, and how often these gifts are thrown to the winds by producers who wish to be original. And by people who write about literature, who themselves are, they don't see the spiritual significance of Shakespeare as they do see, for example, Paradise Lost, Milton's poem Paradise Lost. But Milton is much less intellectual than Shakespeare in the true sense of the meaning of the word. I remember, to go back to C.S. Lewis, I remember attending a lecture of his. His lectures were very well attended in those days. He was an extraordinarily good lecturer, and the room was packed with students, even who were not they were mostly English students. And he was lecturing on life in the Middle Ages, in England especially. And he pointed out that students were taught that the human being has four faculties, four main faculties. He said that this was the influence of it come down from the early Middle Ages, from Copernicus, I think, or no, I forget who, from not Copernicus, from I forget who, anyway, it doesn't matter, but he said they were taught that the human being has four faculties: intellect, reason, imagination, and the senses. The intellect is concerned with the things of the next world, the hereafter, only. It is not concerned with the things of this world.
The intellect.
The reason, which works under the domination of the intellect, is concerned with the things of this world. The same applies to imagination at a slightly lower level, and the senses, finally, are the meeting place of soul and body. It's difficult to say where the soul ends and where the body begins as regards the senses. But the intellect, when I heard that the intellect is concerned only with the things of the next world, of the hereafter, I was so, because I'd always heard the word intellect wrongly used, you see. Mm-hmm. I realized that this was what I, it was a wonderful piece of knowledge to have. To hear that the people who were described normally as one of the leading intellectuals of our day was a man who was anti-intellectual, precisely. That the intellect was a faculty which was concerned with spiritual things. And that was all part of it. It fitted into what I was learning about Shakespeare. Well, Shakespeare must have had that, must have been told, he must have had that same idea taught him probably about the intellect that I'm speaking.
You had mentioned in your writing about Dante that he refers to four levels of interpretation.
Yes.
The literal, allegorical, moral, and anagogical or esoteric.
Yes.
Should the reader of Shakespeare's works anticipate that one or more of these are to be found, and indeed, for full appreciation, be understood that these levels exist?
Those levels mentioned by Dante do certainly exist in Shakespeare's plays. And it's necessary to understand those. In some cases, it's the play is centered on the last, the highest of those meanings.
I think in your own writing, I've seen pointed out, and I might paraphrase it, and you said that what Shakespeare does is he gives a taste of that spiritual wisdom, each to his own capacity. Here is the quote here. In considering how Shakespeare conveys his passage to us, we must remember that the true function of art is not didactic. And then I'll let you take a look at that line. Not didactic.
Yes, naturally, a great drama or epic may contain little or much teaching of a didactic kind, but it does not rely on that teaching in order to gain its ultimate effect. Its function is not so much to define spiritual wisdom as to give us a taste of that wisdom, each according to his capacity. We may quote in this connection a profound remark that has been made about sacred art.